y'all don't mind, let's go back to a time when we really used to have church. We used to have a good time, praising the Lord, in spirit and in truth.
I love them old
that old brother, pick up that old hymn book and you knew exactly what he was going to say. Sisters got happy, folks start patting their feet, clapping their hands, and all of a sudden, he break off in a song, something like this.
I want to talk to you this morning from the subject matter, Acquainted with Grief. Acquainted with Grief. What an interesting passage of scripture. I believe in verse 3 or 4, Isaiah 53. Man of sorrows. Something about grief is sorrowful. It is the rejection that one feels in this trilogy of pain. It's Jesus who is being prophesied of his coming by the prophet Isaiah. And he says that he was rejected, sorrow and grief. He was acquainted, translated, he was acquaintance of loneliness. There is something about loneliness that is diametrically opposed to the very existence of humanity. Ask those who have been to prison what a month in the hole could do to a man. The very baddest men incarcerated, psychologist says, need not to be placed in isolation more than a week, for it has psychological effect on a person in such a way it begins to initiate a mental breakdown. Loneliness will cause codependency. People will, to avoid being alone, will hurry, scary to get married, or move from one relationship to another. Loneliness is consequential and is symptomatic. Loneliness brings about depression and suicidal or homicidal thoughts. Loneliness can interrupt and interfere with the cardiovascular system in our bodies, causing disease and strokes. Loneliness can increase stress levels. Blood pressures rise more than 4 times than it ought to be. Loneliness can cause antisocial behaviors. Loneliness is a contributor to direct and poor decision making. In other words, it is a producer of poor cognitive abilities. Loneliness is a train ride to alcoholism and drug abuse. Loneliness is a slow progression to Alzheimer's disease and many other factors. Yet the Bible says that Jesus was acquainted to loneliness. What a Lord that we serve. He was man and God, and his acquaintance was loneliness. Our Savior, who came and died on Calvary's cross, he knows what it feels like to be abused by loneliness. The scriptures echo over and over again that he was not the most popular person in the church. Amen, anyhow. Amen. While we say we love him and we care about him, in his day, he was a man that was rejected, he was despised, he was humiliated, and he was acquainted with loneliness, sorrows, and grief. Now, preacher, what does that mean to me? Well, it means that when I am suffering from loneliness, that I serve a Savior who understands what I'm going through.
Amen.
Y'all ought to say amen. He understands that loneliness is a type of domestic violence. Ask any couple that's been together for a little while. When someone wants to control you, when someone wants to manipulate you, they'll stop talking to you. They won't eat with you. They won't watch TV with you. Their intention is to isolate you and leave you in a lonely state, regardless of how dangerous loneliness is. And when we look at loneliness, we find that not only is it a tool of mass destruction, we find that loneliness is the enemy's number one reason and number one tool to tear down homes and family and Christianity. But I stop by to tell you, it's also conflicting, because sometimes in our decision making, we find ourselves saying that I just want to be alone, but God has fixed it, that he said you'll never be alone. Why is God in my throat right now? Get ready to preach. That's the devil. He don't try to do that. But the devil is alive. The devil is alive. I've been singing all morning, no problem. Then I get ready to preach. He's going to try to mess me. Don't you tell them folk about that, because they mess around. But I'm doing domestic violence workshop, and I was reading psychological journals about loneliness and how couples upon couples are using loneliness and leaving folk alone. You leave a woman alone long enough, she will cheat on you. If you leave a man long enough, he will cheat on you. If you keep on with your antisocial behavior, you will tear up your marriage. Loneliness does that. Loneliness is a violent, solid weapon. It is a killer of both the physiological and the biological and the cognitive function of what God has put to place. And God knew that because he was acquainted with loneliness. So y'all listening to me. God says in his word, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. He's not saying that because he's trying to entertain you. He understands that if the world leave you like they left him, you sure enough will be in trouble. You remember when you look at the scripture, the Bible said that when the day came and they were going to arrest him, that all of his disciples did what? They took off running. They left him by himself. Have you ever felt isolated and by yourself?
Amen.
It's interesting. It's interesting, even in the church, when they want to discipline you because you don't want to do something like they said to do, because you don't see things like they see things. The first threat that they have is that we'll isolate you and we'll leave you by yourself. But I'm happy this morning that I have a Savior that's acquainted with loneliness and sorrow and grief. Because when I'm feeling lonely, I always remember that God has already fixed my lonely problem. Am I right about it?
Amen.
God said in his word in Matthew 20 and 28, lo, I'm with you always, even unto the end of the world. Uh-huh. Folk may leave you, might not like you, nor talk to you. But just remember that howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he'll guide you in all truth.
Amen.
If you feel like you're by yourself, every now and again you ought to shout, Holy Spirit, or you with him. All right, about it.
Amen.
As a matter of fact, sometime when you feel like you're alone, we can sing that old song we used to sing. I hadn't heard it in a while, Andy, but you remember that song, Holy Spirit, dwell in me, mm-hmm. Touch my eyes that I might see. Are y'all all right?
Amen.
Holy
Amen.
Spirit, rest. Me. I don't know about y'all, but every now and again I need rescuing from myself. Because when I get by myself, I start thinking crazy stuff. Y'all know I'm right back. I mean, sometimes you by yourself, you start to ought to hit that person upside the head. And out of the Holy Spirit, rescue me. Y'all like saying, man, being by yourself is a dangerous thing. Because of rejection is a hard thing. Am I right about it?
Uh-huh.
When folk reject you, it is to suggest you're not good enough for them. When they reject you, it is a form of oppression. When they reject you, it means we set you aside to be humiliated, to be mocked like they did Jesus. Am I right about it? Uh-huh. And if anybody knows how rejection feels, God knows.
Amen.
He was rejected. The Bible said in John 1 and verse number 11, he came to his own, and his own received him not. Am I right about it? I know how Jesus felt when you get rejected in your own house. Sometime, as a preacher, I can walk into the house of God and folks will sit down and act like I don't have feelings and treat me like I'm not human. Am I right about it? They won't shout amen when you're preaching. Won't encourage you. Am I right about it? Sometime I feel rejected and I want to say, Lord, I feel lonely. I feel lonely. And Lord, if you don't help me through this sermon, I'm not. Look how they're looking at me, Lord. Look how they treat me. They won't even shake my hand. Somebody finally gave me some water. Thank you, sister. Praise God. But sometime I know what he felt like when he felt that he was rejected for trying to stand on God's word. Loneliness. We'll find that even by his hometown folk, that's one thing to be rejected by folk that you don't know. But when you're rejected in your own Bethlehem, Matthew 13, 57 and verse 58, when you're rejected by your own folk that you grew up with, it's a rough feeling. Am I right about it? They done got two pennies they can rub together, and now they act like they better than you. But I remember you when you were barefooted, snotty nosed, nappy headed, and your wife was off like my wife. Y'all are the same kind. But now you act like you better. Then am I right about it? We drank out the same Kool-Aid jug. Am I right about it? We shared the same chicken. And you had a nerve to think you could reject. But let me tell you something. Just because you reject me, God will never reject me. Because he knows what rejection feels like. All right. Y'all ought to say amen.
Amen.
Something about loneliness. Acquainted with loneliness. Not only is it hard being rejected with folk that you don't know, folk that you do know, but then being rejected while you're trying to help folk. Am I right about it?
Uh-huh.
All Jesus was trying to do is to go to the cross, am I right about it? And die for man's sin. But the Bible says in Matthew 27, verse 39 through 43, that when he got to the cross, all men forsook him. I want you to know something in life. When you're going through stuff, and you're bearing your cross, that's the time that friends and family and foes will reject you and leave you at the cross all by yourself. But y'all act like y'all can't relate to that. Sometime, because you have some homeboys and some homegirls and some church folk, you'll take your car note money and lend it to them to help them make it past their storm. You'll tell them, I need that car note back by the 15th, or I'm gonna be on the trolley system. I'm gonna write about it. The repo man is calling and saying, now you know I told you couldn't be late no more. And I need my car note. And you held up, but I let Brother Mojo borrow it. And I just know he gonna pay me back. And you call Brother Mojo to answer the phone. And I said, Mojo, I'm on the cross now. You know I'm trying to help you, Mojo. Could you give me back my car note? And Mojo said, no, speak English. Leave me by myself. And I write about it. Oh, it's a rough thing to leave you at the cross. But it was at the cross, where I first saw the light. Amen. And my burdens of my heart, they rolled away. It was there by faith. I received my sight, and now I'm happy all the day. Yeah. Therefore, rejection will then bring the sorrow of tears. You remember there are two instances where Jesus is seen crying, and another time he's sweating tears and bullets. You remember in John chapter 11, verse number 20, 30, the Bible says, John 11, 35, and Jesus wept. And right about it, Jesus crying in John 11, 25. He's crying at Lazarus' funeral. And right about it, once again in John, Matthew 27, and verse number 33, O Jerusalem, how often would I have gathered you together like a mother with his hands? He's crying because he wants to love her. He wants to care about her. He said, but you won't let me love you. Nothing hurts like trying to love somebody that don't want to love you.
Amen.
Oh, the sorrow it brings. All you want to do is love them and care for them, but you will not. And every time I turn around, you're trying to kill me. But he was acquainted with folk like that. I want to in your life, accustomed to folk who's supposed to be your friend, who's supposed to be your homeboy, who's supposed to be in your corner, yet all they bring is grief and sorrow and misery. Yet this Jesus, we find, knew it all too well, and the text says he was acquainted with sorrow. Well, when you are involved with folk who reject you and bring grief in you, you find yourself stealing away in isolation. And you find some things to do when you're lonely, because I want you to know that you're never all alone by yourself. Am I right about it? I'm glad today that if all my friends leave me this very hour, I can hear Peter declare in 1 Peter 5, 6, and 7. He says, cast your cares upon the Lord. Am I right about it? For God cares for me. Every now and again, when folk don't call me, I just call on Jesus. Am I right about it? And I don't know about you, but way over in the midnight hour, early in the morning, I can feel his presence. Oh, I can feel a gentle nudge in my spirit saying everything's going to be all right. Where'd you learn it from? Luke 22, 40 through 46. You remember Jesus was walking with his disciples. He said, you rascals, I want you to watch and pray for me. I'm going to the cross for your sins and to save mankind. And he went about a throne's door and he looked back. Now Joseph had went to sleep while he was trying to save their life. They were going to sleep. And I don't know about y'all, but I've been Jesus. If you still enough to go to sleep and I'm trying to save you, I'd have went to sleep too. Amen. I'd have gotten in there too. If it don't matter to you, don't matter to me. Give me some rest too. But the Bible said he went away and he prayed alone. Jesus prayed by himself. And sometimes you got to learn how, when you by yourself, to start praying to the Lord to keep your spirit.
Amen.
What else can I do by myself? Well, you need to understand that everything you go through, everybody don't need to go through it with you. Amen. Am I right about it? Sometimes you say, first thing you do, you want to call all them old nasty people that's going to talk about you like a dog and invite them to your hearing. Mm-hmm. No, sometimes you need to go to court by yourself.
Amen.
You take you and the Lord, because if they're not going to pay no bail or stand in there and take the sentence, they don't need to be there in the first place.
Uh-huh.
Y'all will get that later. When Jesus went to the court and went before the high priest, he did not have 12 disciples behind him.
Mm-hmm.
When he went to the court, same man, he did not have a family and friends day behind him. The Bible says that he went before the high priest by himself. Matthew 26 and verse number 56. Sometimes you have to pray by yourself. Sometimes you have to go through trials by yourself. And he stood. He stood by himself before the high priest, Luke 22, 63 through 71. He went to court before Pilate by himself. Mm-hmm. Luke 23, he went to the cross by himself. But what you're talking about, I thought being by yourself was bad. Being by yourself is bad. But I'm saying, when you know you got God on your side, there's a whole lot of stuff you can do by yourself.
Amen.
You can pray by yourself. I think it was Little John said, I can do it all by myself.
Uh-huh.
Do it. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Amen. Do it. I don't know what he was doing. But he said, do it all by himself.
Uh-huh.
I want you to know that whatever you face in life, what you need is Jesus. And if you have Jesus, you can make it, because you're no longer by yourself, but the Holy Spirit will guide you through your trials, your court days, your disappointment, your heartache. He said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. I'm always there. Then as I come to a conclusion in his final discourse, as he was leaving, Jesus makes another momentous promise. In John 14 and verse 8, he said, you know what? I'll never leave you comfortless. Hebrews 13 and verse number 5, he says, I'll never forsake you. I don't know about you, but when men say they won't do something, I don't listen to much of that. But when Jesus says, I'll never, the word never, the power, only Jesus can use the word never. He said, I'll never leave you, nor forsake you. If you're here this morning, and if you think you're by yourself, just remember, Jesus said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. Why does he say never? Because he knows what it feels like to be left and forsaken. Am I right about it? He knows the pressure that it feels like to be left all alone. meant what he said. Am I right about it? He said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. And the Hebrew writer put it this way, therefore, let us boldly go to his throne of grace and help in a time of trouble. Because there we can find help for our needs. Am I right about it? Jesus said, you'll never have to worry. And if you just reach out of your spirit, I'm always right there.
Amen.
That's what helps me feel good. Somebody said, I saw you yesterday. You were riding down the street, and you was just smiling while you was riding. Jesus was riding with me, am I right about it?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I saw you. I saw the other day you were sitting having breakfast by yourself. And you raised your hand, and who was you? I was giving God glory for the pig that died for me to eat that bacon. Am I right about it? I saw you, and you were shopping. God took me shopping. Am I right about it? I'm never by myself. As long as I got the Holy Spirit, everything is going to be all right.
Amen.
Everybody say amen. I said, you're here today, and you don't have the Holy Spirit. You're by yourself. How do I get the Holy Spirit? Acts 2:38, those that were baptized said, you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Brother Henry, I was baptized. Well, I want you to know something. You've been ignoring the Holy Spirit because it's been right there. You've never been by yourself. Men are going to turn their back on you. Men are nasty. Their heart is wicked. Who can know it? One day they cool, the next day they don't like you. One day she thinks you're the best man in the world, the next day you're the scum of the earth. You better put your trust in God.
Amen.
You better put your trust in God. Because God will pass all the stink and the dirt and see his child. Y'all say amen. And God knows what he's doing.
Amen.
Here today you heard the word of God. You believe what you've heard. Repent of your sin. Confess the sweetest name of mortal tongue. Put him on in baptism. You can leave here never to be alone again. He is acquainted with loneliness, which means he knows what it feels when folk don't act right.
Amen.
He knows what it feels when folk don't treat you right. He said, and because of that, I'll never let you have to worry about that. It's me and you against the world, the new birth.